pandemic has pushed longstanding issues of health disparities in communities of color to the fore. And today we're joined by Olmsted County Commissioner Sheila Kiscaden, here to tell us about a new study the county is undertaking to take a closer look at the intersection of race and public health locally. Welcome to our town, Sheila.
I'm glad to be here. Thanks for the invitation.
So I know a lot of cities and municipalities are talking about what it means for racism to be a public health crisis. Can you talk a little bit about what that means?
Well, you know, I think public health is the place where you diagnose what's going on with the health of a community, and you look for what the community's experiences, and you look for what the solutions can be so everybody can be healthy. So it's that's where you get the science kind of people. Public health people have been talking about this for a long time. They use different language. They talk about social determinants of health. They talk about health equity. I chaired a task force a few years ago for the state on health equity. So this isn't new to public health at all. And in fact, our community health needs assessment looked this time at health disparities, some specific health disparities, and that we do that every 3 years. So we have some local data. But what's new is the general awareness of the broader public that we really do have structural problems that disadvantage some folks and that we end up with really different health outcomes for different people. You know, we joke in public health that your zip code should not determine your health. And in too many places across our country, including a bit right here, your zip code can determine your health. That can be a good predictor of what kind of health outcomes you're going to have.
Yeah, no, that certainly resonates. And, you know, we're the home of the Mayo Clinic. We've got ongoing efforts to make this America's city for health. You know, you mentioned some of the community needs assessment. What are some of the persisting health disparities that we do see here locally, especially now in this COVID-19 environment?
Well, one of the big ones is diabetes. People of color in our community are much more likely to have diabetes, like 3 times as likely. And if you have diabetes, especially if you start as a juvenile, but even if you get it as an adult, it just predisposes you to all sorts of other kinds of health conditions. And then we know that with COVID-19, diabetics are particularly vulnerable. So you're more likely to have diabetes if you're a person of color in our community, particularly an African American. And then if you're exposed and get COVID and you're more likely to be exposed, lots of times because of where you're working, that's one of the structural issues, the differences between races is who's in what kind of work environment. And then if you get it, you're much more likely to have complications. And I think what we're learning is if you have that underlying conditions, you're more at risk for death, but you're also at risk for other organs to be affected long-term from having the virus. So that would be an example. Obesity is another example. Obesity is, you know, one of the COVID-19 conditions of predictors is obesity, and I qualify. We look at that factor. If you look at any national statistics around health disparities among people of color, particularly African Americans have higher health risk in almost every category than people of Asian descent or of Hispanic descent, you know, Hispanic ethnicity. It can be any number of races. But yes, I'm trying to think of a couple of other specifics. Let me look at my list here. Here, a big one. This is a structural issue, financial stress. People of color reported to us 3 times as more likely to be under financial stress. People of color in our community, African Americans, are more likely to be renters. Renters are finding housing very unaffordable, particularly lower income members of our community. And of course, we know that there is a connection between a predictive connection. It's not a cause and effect. You know, if you're an African American, you're more likely to be poor than if you're a white American. White Americans are poor too, Asian Americans are poor too, but you're more likely. And poverty is a predictor of less access to health. So when we asked our local people about access to healthcare, if you don't have a good income, you're not likely to go in and have that preventative care. You don't get the preventative care, then you're more likely to have, you don't get the treatment you need and you're more likely to have complications. So these things nest all together. That's why they talk about the structural parts, of the structures that keep people from being healthy or have equal opportunities.
Yeah, it's a really comprehensive picture you're painting about all the structural systemic things that are impacting your body and how healthy you are. So can you tell us pretty briefly what prompted the decision to conduct the study and what entities are going to be involved in putting it
forward? Yeah, you know, it's, I think right now, George Floyd's murder was really, has created a huge awakening across the nation and actually now across the world. And all across the world, we're saying, what does this tell us? And so some things that maybe public health people knew, now other people are asking about some of these structural issues that disadvantage some. And so it's a piece of that. But, you know, like I said, I wasn't on a health disparities, health equity task force 4 years ago. We've been measuring health disparities in our community. Our report came out a year ago. But the moment kind of came together. And in June, all over the country, public health departments began declaring race as a public health crisis. Well, we were already kind of there. We said, we don't have to declare the crisis. We know we've got a problem. And what we really want to do is make this a public health issue that we ask our public health advisory board and our human rights commission to look at. So on public health, you've got a lot of people with health expertise. And in the human rights commission, you've got people who are there to kind of speak for the underrepresented in our community, to speak for the rights of our residents. And so you want that connection between the science and the community. And felt to us like the human rights commission and the public health department doing a joint study, looking at our data, looking at what we're already doing, looking at what else we can do. We've asked them to come back with actionable items. We wanted to do more than just do a proclamation. We want to have a plan of action that we can implement and measure how well are we doing and are we changing the trend lines on these disparities.
Well, thank you so much, Sheila. We are going to be looking forward to the results of that study and checking back in with you later on this year. Thanks for joining us.
I look forward to it as well.
Our Town is brought to you in part by the following amazing people and organizations:
the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, and the citizens of Minnesota.
And the members of KSMQ Public Television. Thank you.
Be sure to stick around. We have more great stories coming your way next. We visit the new Grief UnMasked exhibit at the Rochester Art Center, and we hear about the plans that the Rochester schools have made about the upcoming school year. But up first, we check out what's new as they welcome a new president and CEO at the Rochester Symphony in this week's Art Culture segment.
March, we were to put on our fifth concert of the season. The date was Friday the 13th. We were having our dress rehearsal that night in preparation for a concert the next evening. And the governor announced no meetings of people of a group larger than 250.
It's March 14th, 2020, and these members of the Rochester Symphony in Minnesota were going to play a concert tonight. But in recognition of everything that's afflicting our community, our nation, and the world, we've decided to be safe and postpone the concert.
I'm Amy Lindstrom. I'm the president and CEO of the Rochester Symphony.
I'm Jerry Lance, artistic director of the Rochester Symphony.
Well, I started talking to the board before COVID hit about this possibility. And we had known that this was coming. Jerry made no secret of that. He had the plan in place. He gave us plenty of notice in order to make the transition. But then COVID hit about a week after I started talking to the board. And so as I was first planning to potentially move into this position, the outlook was quite different at that time than it is now, as it turns out. It's just made what we have normally done very challenging to think about doing. And so even though I do have a great deal of experience, it's also creating an opportunity for creativity and figuring out how to still bring great music to life in this time period that we can't do that on stage together.
At our League of American Orchestras conference, we were advised to make up at least three plans for the future. One was start in the fall, as usual, when symphony orchestras start their seasons. Two, delay that start until the new year, early in 2021, or start the following fall, in the fall of 2021.
So right away when we had to move away from performing in large venues as large groups for large audiences, we asked our musicians if they would consider submitting solo videos from their homes wherever they were. So it was kind of like from my living room to your living room.
Hi, I'm Tiffany. I play with the Rochester Symphony.
To potentially do some small ensemble performances, either in person or online or some combination of the two. We want to do everything that we can to be able to share our music together long term. And so if we need to take a break in the short term, we'll certainly do that. But we are doing what we can to have an online presence. And even if we were to do in-person small ensemble performances with spaced audience, we're also looking at ways to stream those or to record those so that we can provide that content to those audience members who perhaps aren't willing to come in person.
If people aren't quite so interested in symphonies, they need something to lift the spirit in a light way. So we're going to do things that are perhaps a little shorter and poppier and fun in our online presence than we might normally in concerts. But hey, we'll have fun with it too.
For more information about this story and other Our Town features, connect with us on Facebook, Twitter at KSMQ hashtag Our Town, or ksmq.org/ourtown.
According to Olmsted County election officials, a record number of Olmsted County voters cast absentee ballots in the August 11th primary. As of Thursday morning, 16,100 Olmsted County residents voted via an absentee ballot, and 7,300 showed up at the polls. This includes 13,137 returned absentee ballots from Rochester voters and 5,600 Election Day ballots cast at Rochester polling places. For more information about the Olmsted County elections and voting results, check out the county website at co.olmsted.mn.us/vote. Opa! Coming up last weekend in August, enjoy a celebration of Greek food, fun, and hospitality while staying safe in your car at the Drive-Thru Greek Fest. The menu includes gyro, souvlaki, spanakopita, and a full assortment of authentic Greek food. Order your food, pick it up, carry it home, or to your workplace, a park, or wherever else you can safely distance and enjoy. The Drive-Thru Greek Fest will be held at 703 West Center Street. Make sure to enter at the intersection of 7th Avenue and Center Street, where someone will meet you to take your order and deliver your food. The drive-thru is open from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. on Friday, August 28th, and on Saturday, August 29th, and at 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Sunday, August 30th. For more details about the festival or the menu, check out the Rochester Greek Fest website at GreekFestRochester.com. And calling all filmmakers, the Minnesota Music Video Menagerie is looking for submission. The Battle of the Band Style Music Video Festival will take place Saturday, August 29th. The rain date for the event will be on Sunday, August 30th. In partnership with Spectrum Pro Audio and the History Center of Olmsted County, the Minnesota Music Video Menagerie is a drive-in event. Attendees tune into the audio on FM radio while watching the video safely separated 6 feet apart in their own vehicles, then use their headlight to vote for the top 5 videos. The submission deadline is August 20th and entry is free. All submissions can be sent to minnesotamusicvideomenagerie@gmail.com. The full list of requirements can be found on the Facebook event page at Minnesota Music Video Menagerie. Coming up next, we head to the Rochester Art Center to explore Grief UnMasked, an art exhibit created by local high schoolers who dealt with grief through their art by creating masks inspired by the person they lost. And this week's What About Sam?
We were already going into the schools and doing grief groups. And one of the projects that we would have the kids do is we would have them draw a picture of who they were before the death and who they are right now in the midst of their grief. And one of the students drew a mask. She was still involved in all the same things, but she had to wear a mask because her friends didn't want her to be sad, and she didn't want her teachers to treat her differently. So that really was the catalyst for Grief Unmasked. It was an epiphany that we all have layers. We all wear masks. We provided an opportunity one time a week for students to come in, and we would talk about our grief and we would do some education on grief. Tears are okay. Your grief is unique to you. We can't compare our grief. It comes in waves. It's not linear. It's back and forth. Every week we looked at a different aspect of our grief, and that's how the layers started to happen. The first week it was paint, and it was a base color. How have you changed through your grief? What's different now? And then we looked at feelings and how to cope with those feelings. We really wanted the grief group to become a place they could take that mask off and be themselves and be real. They found that they weren't alone and that it was okay to grieve. You know, we call it transformational grief or transformative grief, but what do you want to take from this person moving into your future to make you into a better person?
You smile when you see me looking, and I know just what you've been cooking.
The status of school openings this fall has been at the center of recent debates and decision-making across the nation as we find ourselves still very deep in the COVID-19 pandemic. Today, we're joined by Rochester School Board Chair Deborah Seelinger to tell us what the Rochester schools are planning as we start the new school year. Welcome to our town, Deborah.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So I know the school board just met on Monday, August 10th. What was the outcome of that meeting?
So we had a great discussion, a long presentation, and we did approve the base model plan to start our school year with in fall.
Awesome. Can you walk us a little bit through that that base model plan? How is elementary school going to be delivered in middle school and high school and all those details?
Sure. So elementary school students will be going to doing a hybrid model. So right now we're looking at an A group and a B group. So A group would go Monday, Tuesday. B group would go Thursday, Friday. Wednesday would be distance learning for all. And then our secondary students, that's 6th through 12th grade, will be distance learning to start the year.
And for the students that are going to be in the hybrid model and in school, will the students and staff and teachers be required to wear face masks? Are there going to be any disinfecting, sanitizing procedures while students are actually physically in school?
Sure, we have a lot of requirements and guidance from the Minnesota Department of Education and Minnesota Department of Health. So we are probably going to be bringing forward a mask policy, although we know that that's something that's sort of out there in the community anyway, but we'll do a district-specific mask policy with guidance from the School Board Association. And then our cleaning protocols for sure will be updated and kind of scheduled. One of the reasons we chose to do the AB or the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday off, attend Thursday, Friday for our elementary, is that we can do a more deep cleaning on that Wednesday day between our groups. And so I think that will help a lot. Playgrounds will be sanitized every morning. And then we'll kind of try to suggest the kids play more in the grassy space as opposed to on the structures. But we're going to do our best, and we're going to take every precaution we can to keep our students safe.
So of course, you know, it's so hard to find. There's so many different types of students and families out in the community, and finding the best model has been probably the biggest struggle and the biggest challenge for you all. What options are available for students that may be in special programs or might be more medically vulnerable, or maybe families that may not want to be participating in a hybrid model?
So we're really fortunate, I think, that Governor Walz said every family has to have the option to go distance learning. And so they don't need a medical excuse. They don't need to justify that. They can choose that based on their situation. So that's going to help a lot. And then in terms of our special programs, especially our special ed students, they're going to have a variety of individualized schedules. So some of them might be able to come into our buildings more often, to have a little bit more face-to-face interaction. We've also talked about having maybe our English language learner students be able to have a little bit more connection with teachers. We know that those populations might be a little bit more vulnerable when it comes to straight distance learning practice.
And of course, this is a whole new world for teachers as well. What are the plans or sort of considerations around any additional training for teachers to navigate these virtual resources and distance learning?
Yeah. So teachers always have a back to school week for teachers, and they get a lot of professional development and get to spend time in their buildings and working with their colleagues. And so this year, administration asked us for two additional days to do some professional development for teachers. A lot of that will be geared towards, using the Google Suites for Education. That's going to be the platform that we're all going to use. How to teach, just some more practice about teaching distantly on those days. And so I think it's a really good plan starting the beginning of the school year to give them some more opportunities to learn and get prepared. We know this is going to be a big lift, and so we wanted to afford them that opportunity.
Sure. What is the tentative timeline for when all of this is going to sort of kick into place? And then is there any built-in flexibility during the school year should things get hopefully better, but worse as well?
Yeah, so right now we're looking at a September 2nd start date, which is a few days later, like I said, for those professional development days. And then somewhere in October, we want to make a decision kind of for our next chunk of time so that families would know when they come back from MEA what the next period will look like. A lot of that will, of course, be driven by our COVID cases in the county and specifically in Rochester. And so, yes, we are hoping, or I am personally hoping, that perhaps we can become more, less restrictive, let's say. And then, but we do know that if there is a spike in cases or an outbreak in a building, that we have the ability to close things down really quickly, at least in terms of getting our students out, but then giving, there's a 5-day period to kind of readjust for staff, and that's from the governor as well.
Distance learning model that schools had to switch to abruptly in the spring also kind of made us realize that there were a lot of inequalities around access to technology and other necessary learning resources. So how are the schools working to address some of those gaps as we get into this new school year?
So we worked really hard on making sure every family, at least their home, had a device, and then if possible, every student. So there is a survey online now asking every family to fill out for their technology needs. We also did over the summer or in the spring, some hotspots on the buses that were handing out food. And so we put those out every day for access for Wi-Fi. So we're gonna keep, we know that that's a need, and we're gonna keep on with some community partners to make sure that students have access, that that's not gonna be a barrier to their learning.
You mentioned the buses with food, and another issue that also come up in the spring was how much schools provide such essential services like food assistance or serving as a safe space for those students that might be facing domestic abuse or homelessness. So what are going to be some of the resources that are going to be continue to be available for students?
Yeah, so we still will be able to serve our students breakfast and lunch so when they're in school for our elementary students, and then have some, like we have in the past, have drive-up sites to pick up food, breakfast and lunch for families. Now we will go back to our fee-based structure as we're usually in, and that's per federal guidelines. So that will be there. Also, I feel like we really put some supports for students in terms of mental health and access to counselors so that students will either be able to email or chat or virtual meet or even go in and meet with some of those support personnel that they might need if they're vulnerable or just need extra support.
So what advice do you have for any parents or guardians out there listening as they're preparing their kids for back to school?
I think for parents, my biggest piece of advice is to think about how your attitude gets reflected in your child's attitude. We are all stressed and nervous and concerned and all those emotions. But I think if we can project to our children that we're going to be okay, we're going to get through this. It might not be how we've always had to do it. It might be difficult, but just kind of having the best positive attitude that you can in these times, I think is going to really help our students. We know our students are probably way more resilient than we give them credit for. We know that as adults, you know, we know what school is like, we know what to expect, but I think we need to give them some credit to find some opportunities and positive lights in all of this, and so really to support them that way.
I love how you said that kids are very resilient. And what advice, as we're wrapping up here, would you have for kids as they're looking into the, yeah, starting the new school year?
You know, supporting the kids, I really want to say, especially to our high school kids, our upper kids, let us know what's working and not working. We've really seen student voice really get sparked and come alive over the last few months. And, you know, they are going to be our leaders in so many ways. So if they're seeing opportunities for us to do things better, you know, reach out to your teachers, your principals, your, you know, school board superintendent and say, hey, how about trying this? This might help serve us better. So, you know, really to the students, hang in there, do your best, but also let us know how it's going.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Deborah, for sharing all that with us. And thank you for joining us. That's all for us today on Our Town, the show about Rochester. Be safe and stay well. We will see you next week. We'll be right back.